I know to many of you right now, especially, you know, if you just went over to Leviticus, the first chapter, we just read verse number 1 through verse number 9, a lot of you probably have never visited that book or that area of scripture before. Then there are some of you that have taken a look at that area of scripture, but I would say to anyone that don't have a good, clear grasp on the scriptures, that when you start dealing with the book of Leviticus, it is a very challenging book to understand. But it's not so challenging when you've done your study about pretty much the whole counsel, Genesis all the way to Revelations. When it comes to that, it's not that much of a challenge. Amen? But the truth of the matter is, in order to gain a clear understanding of what Paul wrote to the church at Rome, that which we just read in the 12th chapter of Romans, to really understand what he talks about as he introduced the concept of us presenting our bodies as a living sacrifice, holy and acceptable unto God, which is our reasonable service, to really understand, and I'm just using the term, that concept. Because the concept is an idea, of course, is a thought process. To understand that, it's really good for us to understand the acts of the Old Testament laws, ceremonies, and behaviors that God wanted them to be a part of. And then now you can clearly understand what he means by presenting yourself. Amen?
Amen.
With that being said, I'd like to talk about this morning, you might want to write this down, expanding through the power of sacrifice. Expanding. You can say expanding yourself, expanding your walk, expanding who you are as a person through the power of sacrifice. Amen? Tell somebody this year, this year,
in this year,
I want to expand.
I want to expand.
I understand that my expansion will always take place if I sacrifice unto God. Amen. If you believe that, give God a hand of praise. Amen. I want you this morning to not only consider the word sacrifice from a spiritual perspective, but since the majority of our lives and the activity of our lives every single day has more to do with just us living a natural life, dealing with natural things and things of that nature, I want you to understand sacrifice also from a natural perspective. Amen?
Amen.
Because not only if we sacrifice unto God from a spiritual perspective, we can find ourselves walking in power. But even from a natural perspective, if you decide to do something in the natural, or even in the secular, if you sacrifice yourself even in the secular realm, you can find yourself walking in a type of power, or, and when I use the word power, a type of authority. Amen. So when we consider the word sacrifice, many times you have to think about the payoff. Somebody say the payoff.
Payoff.
After the process of sacrificing has been completed. Amen.
Amen.
And then so if a person is a thinking person, and they're able to process, if I sacrifice now, the payoff for me later on could be beneficial to me. Does that make sense? However, at the same time, when you start thinking about that word sacrifice, the word sacrifice automatically calls some people to say, oh, Because that might mean I might have to go to work. Sacrifice might mean, I might have to change my behavior patterns.
Amen.
Sacrifice might mean, I might have to stop doing what I'm doing. Sacrifice might mean, if I'm going to get that, I got to give up this. Somebody say sacrifice. And so when you start thinking about the word sacrifice, church, a lot of time it's like, whoa, that sounds like work. Amen? Well, the truth of the matter is, anytime you're sacrificing, some work is going to be involved. If no work is involved, it's not a sacrifice. Am I right, Deacon? It's not a sacrifice. It's only a sacrifice when you're willing to go to work. Amen?
Amen?
The word sacrifice simply means to surrender. Somebody say surrender.
Surrender.
And to take it farther and to make it even more plain, it means to actually bring about destruction to a thing in your life. Destroy something that you might prize now for something that has a greater value that you can prize later.
All right.
So in other words, you have to decide that I'm going to destroy it now because of the payoff that I desire to have later. Does that make sense?
Amen.
It's like abandoning. Because I got it right now. It's good for me right now, but what I desire to have later is better for me, so I'm going to abandon that so I can cling afresh to this right here. It's better for me here.
Amen.
Are you with me? It's relinquishing. Somebody say relinquishing. You know, sometimes if I've gotten wrapped up in a thing, man, to relinquish that situation or relinquish that thing is difficult. Just think about the habits that we all have. Some of us, we like to watch a lot of television. It's nothing wrong with watching a lot of television, being a part of a lot of different activities, and being a part of a lot of different sports activities or just entertainment in general. There is nothing at all wrong with that.
Amen.
Not at all. However, you have to decide that if this is good for me, and I know that there is something better for me, I might have to give up television watching now for something much later that's going to be much valuable to me. Does that make sense? And that can be a hard task because I got my favorite show that I love to watch on certain nights. That's a sacrifice, Pastor. That's a sacrifice. And so we have all of these different habits in our lives. We have habits that we have to go to a certain place. We have habits that we have to do certain things. We have all kinds of different habits that we're dealing with every single day. And it's hard for me to break that habit because I value the habit that I built up in my life.
Yes.
And so now when you start talking about me giving that up or sacrificing my habits that I've been a part of for 20, 30, 40 years to give that up for something that I feel is going to be better for me, and you're saying it's going to be better for me, that is a major sacrifice. And I'm not saying that what you have now is not valuable. It is valuable. A lot of value in that. I remember when I was a young boy, I remember we were living in, it was in downtown Baton Rouge at that time. My parents had bought me For Christmas, I had a bicycle with, I never did get the tricycle. I don't know what, they missed me. Oh, man, I never did get the tricycle. We got to talk to them back then, but they never gave me the tricycle. But they gave me a bike that had training wheels on it. We ain't couldn't afford the tricycle. What happened to the tricycle, y'all? But they gave me a bicycle that had training wheels on it. And a few hours later on, now when they got me the bicycle, it was full of value. The way my dad put it together, it was full of value. But after a while, about a few hours later, I told dad, I said, look, I just want you to just lift, you know, they used to roll the training wheels up. I don't know if they even do that stuff anymore. Roll them up and then just push you down the street and let you go. I said, dad, I want to be able to ride without the training wheels. Y'all know what I'm talking about? Yeah. Now watch this, the training wheels had value. Because it kept you supported and balanced, just in case you may take the fall. It helped you to kind of rebalance yourself. Am I right? But after a while, because of my own value system at probably the age of maybe 4 years old, 5 years old at that time, my value system said, now I want you to devalue the training wheels and value just the two wheels and learn how to ride on the two versus the four. Does that make sense? Everything had value. But the training wheels no longer to me had any more value because I wanted a different set of values to be a part of my life. Does that make sense? In every last one of us in here, we got some good stuff, some value in our life, and even some things around us that's very valuable. But now, you have to decide what is more valuable to me. Is it what I've decided that is valuable to me, or is it what he wants for my life that I am to value more? Does that make sense? Because the thing is, when you talk about relinquishing and abandoning, it's like giving up something that is worth something for something that is so, so, so much better. Come on, y'all. As we continue to grow up, let them in. As we continue to grow up, now the training with the little bike was good. But now I began to grow. And my sisters probably attest to this fact that when we begin to grow, I remember my mom by my, y'all know what happened to y'all bikes. This is a 10-speed era now. They never had bikes, y'all. They never had bikes. I'm sorry. Y'all talk to mama about that. Daddy's gone. See, we ain't grow up with no silver spoon in our mouth like these children today. Growing up with silver spoons in their mouth, Lord, don't appreciate nothing. But now as we begin to grow and we became teenagers, now we couldn't be riding around on those little small bikes. Our value system grew as we continued to grow. We're going somewhere now. We're going somewhere because we're growing up. So my parents bought us 10 speeds. And boy, we used to ride those 10 speeds everywhere. These kids don't know nothing about that kind of stuff. We ride those 10 speeds 20, 30 miles all day long. And boy, we'd come back at night and everything was good. Safe, secure, sound. Mom and daddy got a nice meal because they know that if you go over there acting a fool, the parents over there gonna get you. Then you'll come back home. We didn't have cell phones to get the word across the street. But as soon as you got home, somehow they got the news. Because everybody valued everybody. Community was about community. it yet, y'all. We're going to shout a little later on. Is that all right? See, we lost too much, church. And we allow these children to lose it also because we're not telling them how valuable they are and the things that God really wants for their lives. We got to wake up and really smell the coffee now. We got some stuff that took place on last Friday that I believe we better, we better really get valuable to each other and for nobody else. Are y'all here? So when it comes to the people of God, now my parents bought us these bicycles and bar. We were shifting gears, we were clutching it, and then we had nice brakes and bar because our value grew.
Yes.
We needed more.
Yes.
Then we continued to grow. No, put the bicycle away.
Right.
Now I gotta buy me a car. Now, I think I was the only child that bought my first car myself. Now, I don't know what happened there either. I'm telling you, Dad bought my brother one, bought my sister one, bought them one, they shared it going to college, but I was left out. I had to buy my own. $350 later, I got one. You can only imagine what kind of car that was. But I paid for it with my own hands and cash.
All right.
Come on now, y'all. That's all right. Somebody say, I remember those days. Man, you talking about hooped it. Yeah, we hooped it all the way down the street. Deacon, you know what I'm talking about? Deacon said, I had one too, Pastor. Somebody say, sacrifice. It was a sacrifice for me to save $350. And see, nowadays, everybody wants something given to them. They want your anointing. They want your authority. They want your power. They want your peace. They want your joy. They want your... Oh, come on. No, you got to work for something, sacrifice for it, and then God will... Are y'all here? So moving into this morning's message, again in Romans 12, verse number 1, verse number 2, where we consider Paul's exhortation, Paul begins to exhort the church in Rome, and he says there, present your bodies a living sacrifice, holy, acceptable unto God, which is our reasonable service, and be not conformed to this world, but be transformed by the renewing of your mind, that you may prove that which is good and acceptable and perfect will of God. So Paul simply here, he takes on the language of sacrifice. And of course he grabs this all the way from the old and bring it, fast forward it up to the new in order for the people to understand. Because they had a clear understanding of what sacrifice was back then. But now again, he wanted them to understand what sacrifice means up here now. Amen? The word sacrifice, we talked about this the other day, it comes from the Greek word zabak, amen, which simply means to, you understand, it simply means to properly, somebody say properly.
Properly
slaughter before the Lord. Properly slaughter, amen. It means that if you're going to slaughter something, you got to do it in a proper, somebody say, manner. In other words, you cannot properly kill or properly slaughter an animal that is in the flesh without taking care and taking down the animal completely and entirely. Amen? That simply means that you cannot allow this animal, after you properly slaughtered it, to remain alive. You have to properly slaughter the animal, praise the Lord. That means it should not be kicking anymore. It should not be, you know, able to move around. You have to properly slaughter the animal. Can somebody say, praise the Lord? That means it can't be alive if it's being presented to be dead. Amen? It has to die if it's going to be presented to God in the right manner. Praise the Lord. The flesh can't be living. The flesh can't be moving. The flesh can't be active. The flesh got to die. Oh, y'all here? Praise the Lord. Amen? The flesh can't continue to live. The flesh has to be in a position where it is laid there for dead. Come on, y'all. Properly.
says, now I want you to take this upon yourself that you are in a position now to choose as to whether or not you will or will not present yourself. Deaconess Beard, I want to do something. Praise the Lord. I want to do something right now. I want to take this from you. Now you have no control over it because it's in my hands. No control over it at all because I have it in my hands and I have the authority over it. Now it's only when I present it back to you that you have the opportunity to what? Take it. If you want it badly enough, you will not allow anybody to take it from you. Because it's been what? Presented to you. So now what I want you to do, because it's in your control, I want you now to present that to me. Now when it's presented to me, I had nothing to do with the presentation. She just simply took it upon herself to present it to me. Now when it comes to me, because this is as a gift that she gave to me. I didn't work for it. I didn't have to do anything for it. I did not have to labor for it. All I had to do is be in position to what? Receive it. And because I was in position to receive it, I was presented with this gift. Are y'all here praying? Oh, Shabbat. Are y'all here praying the Lord? And so because I've been presented with this gift, now it's in my possession. And so now God says, every good and perfect gift has been given from our Father above, which cometh down in the Father of lights, which whom there is no variableness, neither shadow of turning. So now we present this to God. So God says to us, now listen here. Because of what I've done for you, I want you to now, in return, present what I've done for you and what I've given to you back to come on. Are y'all understanding? Now, that means this is going to be a sacrifice. Let me share with you why it's a sacrifice. Now, in her notebook, I can tell she's taking her time with this notebook.
Yeah.
She's gotten very acquainted with this notebook.
Uh-huh.
Why? Because on this sheet, she has something written. This sheet, she has something written. This sheet, she has something written. So now it's her and she prized what she has.
Yes.
And she don't want anything to happen to her. Because she prized it. It belongs to her. It's valuable to her. But God is saying, though it's valuable to you, I want you to now present it to me.
Yes.
Not just something. Not just anything. Not just something that you leave over that's not valuable to you. I want you to give me something that you really value. And the thing that you value the most, it's your body. Oh, come on, y'all. We work these things out. We pump them with iron. We run them. We jog them. We try to preserve them because we value these bodies. I know I'm talking right. I do it too. Are y'all here? And so Paul is saying to the church, he's saying, now, church, I need you all to understand something. Now, let's take a backwards trip and come up forward. So now when we begin looking in the book of Leviticus, he said, now this is the picture of a presentation. Because what they did in the book of Leviticus was a ceremony, and it was a continuous ceremonial act. They did this constantly. They did this when God said for them to do it. They did this year in and year out. And it was ritualistic. You see what I'm saying? It wasn't something that, praise the Lord, they would simply do without any thought behind it. If they were going to bring something to God, they had to think about what they were going to bring to God. Because why? God had already given the parameters as to what it was he wanted. Are y'all here, praise the Lord? In other words, God had already set the borders, set the boundaries, set the parameters, not what the people wanted to give him, but God I want. I'm God, you're the preacher, I'm the creator. Come on, y'all, give God a praise in this house. So now, he wanted them, somebody say, to expand. And he really wanted them to understand the power of expansion through the process of sacrifice. Let me say that one more time. He wanted them to expand. He wanted them to expand because they would understand the power of expansion through the process of sacrifice. Amen? In other words, while they were going through the process of sacrifice, they were expanding. I don't care who it is, as we said the other day, if you want to be an accomplished pianist and you decide that you're going to put off, you know, playing around and doing all that steam because you want to really know how to flow with those keys, that is a sacrifice. Are you understanding what I'm saying? If you decide that you want to build a business, praise the Lord. Everybody else is out there cutting up, doing things that they should not be doing, but you're holding your skills because you're trying to develop and build a business. You're saying that I can't go with you right now. I can't do what you want us to do at this time because I'm taking on this thing called business building. Praise the Lord. That is a sacrifice. Do you hear me what I'm saying? And so now we begin looking at verse number one. Again, the Bible says that Moses had received the instructions. Moses, I want you to call the assembly together, and I want you to tell them that I want them to prepare themselves to bring me an offering. Now watch this. Because now, if Moses was the one that gained or received the information, he's the one that's given the, what, instructions. He got the information, but now he's given the, what, instructions. Praise the Lord. Of course, Moses was a part of that also, but Moses was the leader. Amen. The husbandman, praise the Lord, that feeding the flock must be the first partaker of the fruit. Amen. So now, here it is in verse number one. Watch this. The thing is, when they were bringing sacrifice. Understand, it can't be rushed. Amen. See, a lot of times we like to rush up on God and give him anything and say it's okay. We don't want to take up a lot of time with God because, Lord, you're taking too long. Here, take that. I gotta go. Lord, my Lord, 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 look, we gotta sit here again. I got things to do. Lord, you mean saying that you want me to bring you a sacrifice? I got to think about what I'm going to bring you? No. Lord, I got too much stuff to going on. But when you slow this thing down, and you look at verse number one, the Bible says that he came and he gave this information to all of the congregation. It wasn't just a specified group. It wasn't just some that probably would and some that probably wouldn't. This information was to be given to everybody in the congregation. Because there is power in this thing called sacrifice for everybody within the congregation. And because God is such a loving God, he didn't want to leave anybody out. He was concerned about the little ones. He was concerned about those that were older. He was concerned about the women. He was concerned about the men. He was concerned about everybody. He wanted to make sure nobody would be left out. Because he wants them to understand the power of sacrifice as they process this whole thing called his will. So when you look at verse number two, the Bible said that he commanded them to give the following instructions to the people of Israel. When you sacrifice to the Lord, use animals from your herd and flock. From your herd, from your flock. If your sacrifice is to be an oxen, given as a burnt offering, use only a bull with no physical defects. Bring the animal to the entrance of the tabernacle where the priest will accept your gift for the Lord. Notice, this is actually a choice assignment. A choice assignment, because now everybody had to decide whether they were going to be obedient or not. Because you've got to understand, Moses had situations just like every shepherd does today. Everybody didn't follow those instructions because some people valued what they had. You're talking about getting a herd? I can't go and steal yours. I can't go and take yours and present it. I have to give this that God wants from me from something that I've grown up and raised up. No physical defects. That means I must be real specific when I make this determination as to what it is God wants me to give him and what I give to God. Are you with me here? I can't just say, well, God, take this. Because God is saying, no, I want something that has no defects in it at all. Can't you imagine? Now, when I go out there and I'm looking at all the animals that I raise, I have to take up time. Man, which is the best? Man, all of them look good. But which one looks the best? Which one has the majority of value? And then, after selecting the best, now you know you have an emotional tie. It's like, I'm gonna tell y'all the truth. I love puppies. I've always loved puppies. And I love seeing dogs have puppies. It's because everybody wanna go, whenever you purchase one, you want to find that best one. Man, because it's just something about that best one. It's like, save that one for me. It's 5 weeks right now, but I know you're going to get rid of it in 6 weeks, but save that one for me, I'll be back. Save that one, put a rope around his neck or something. I'll be back. Because based on what you observe, you want to make sure you have the best. So now, can you imagine the emotional disconnect that you have to make in your own psyche? From that which you raised up and now give God that? Could you imagine? And so God is saying, I want you to present yourself to me in that same like manner. Even that area, even that one little area in your life that you feel that is the very best that you have to offer, I want that part also. Your entire body. Now, I have to think about it. Because now this is a serious sacrifice, because I value this area about me for so long. I'm accustomed to making this kind of money. I'm accustomed to doing these type of things. Now you mean to say you want me to separate myself from that? This is who I am. It's because of that that I become this. No, separate yourself from that, because what I have for you over there is much more valuable than what I have for you right here. Does that make sense? It is not easy. That's why every last one of us in here, church, God has gifted us, and we are the gift of God. So God says now, when the presentation is made, act as if you are a present to me. When you present, be the present. Don't give me nothing that somebody ran over. Don't give me something that you just picked up out of the store shelf and say, here, God. No, I want you to give me a present that is your body, that's complete, that's entire, that's whole. You are the present. Are you here? Look what happened in verse number 3. The Bible there says, verse number 3, it says, again, and he commanded him to give the following instructions to the people of Israel. When you sacrifice to the Lord, use animals from your herd. If your sacrifice is to be an ox given as a burnt offering, use only a bull with no physical defects. Bring the animal to the entrance of the tabernacle where the priest will accept your gift for the Lord. Now, here is a picture. The people, the priest is inside of the temple. He's ready to work on behalf of God. God is ready to do his part on behalf of the priest and the people. But it's still up to the people to decide that they're going to bring this offering, bring this goat, bring this bull to the door.
Yes, yes.
This is why God, Jesus says, I stand at the door and knock.
Hallelujah.
But I just need, when I knock, I need you to what? Let me in.
Yes,
so now here I am, I'm coming to the door of the tabernacle. I get all the way to the door of the tabernacle. What if I decide that I can't make the disconnect and I'm not going to allow you to kill my animal? That means the power that you should be walking in, you will never find yourself walking in because you didn't go through the process of sacrifice. See, a lot of people don't understand how powerful sacrifice is. They think we are doing something because they don't understand how powerful it is. Listen here, church. If you want to go up, you got to give up. It's just that simple, praise the Lord. And most people aren't willing to give up because they don't want to go up. That bad. But Jesus said, now when I get ready, I want you to bring that animal to that door. And then what you have to do when you get to the door is, you don't just let him go on up in there and say, yeah, go on, sheep. Now, the sacrifice gets deeper. Because when you bring this of the offering to the door, now you have to take a knife in your own hands and you have to slay that bull or that goat right there before the priest, and then the priest take it over from there. You gotta let all the blood run out. Make sure it's properly dead. Get all the blood out, then now let the priest take it over from there. Because you got your job, the priest had their job, and God knows he can do his job. Somebody say power. Somebody say sacrifice. Come on, y'all, give God a praise up in this house. That's how powerful it is. And see, a lot of folks don't want to go through because they don't understand the power that happens after the fact. You don't get it before the fact, you get it after the fact. You don't get the blessing before you go through, you get the blessing after you've been through. That's why I say, they that wait upon the Lord shall renew their strength. Let's keep on working. Look at verse number 5. The Bible says, it says, the man shall then kill the animal there before the Lord. See, a lot of folk don't want to kill out stuff enough before the Lord and think they're going to walk in power. You're not walking in no power with God. You might walk in some kind of power, but you're not going to walk in power with God. Because you got to kill, you got to properly slay the animal. Tell yourself, I'm an animal. You got to kill it. I know you don't want to die. You got shall then kill the animal before the Lord. You don't take your animal off and say, hey, Bishop, I'm going to just kill it right here. This will be good enough. I'm going to just take this and I'm going to do this in a quiet place. They'll think I'm dead. No, you're not dead. I can tell you're not dead. Look at your behavior. Look at your attitude. Look at your lifestyle. Look at what you're doing. You ain't not dead. You just alive as you can be. I got some witnesses in this house. Just alive. Talking about you dead. You're not dead. Dead men don't talk like that. You're not dead. Dead men don't walk like that. You're not dead.
Look at 6, 7, and 8. The Bible says, then the priest will, look at this, look,
Now see, again, see, you get the animal to the doorpost, to the door of the tabernacle. Then the priest will skin the animal and quarter it and build a wood fire upon the altar and put the sections of the animal and its head and fat upon the wood. See, the priest got to do his job. If you and I don't bring the priest anything to work with, God doesn't have anything to work with. Does that make sense? You got to decide to bring God something to work with. Yes. We have to decide to give God something to work with. Yes. It's sacrifice. Yes. Lord, I want you to work with me, but you won't come to Him. Yes. I can't do it. Yes. That's why He says, he that cometh to God must first believe that He is, and that He's a rewarder of them that diligently seek Him. That means you gotta decide that, you know what, I'm gonna first of all do my part so God can do His part. Yeah. Nothing from nothing leaves nothing. Right. If there's an open gap between you and God because you didn't do your part, God can't not do His part. Right. Yeah. He can't do it. If people want all this from God, want God's anointing, want God's power, want God's authority, you won't pray to Him, you won't seek His faith, you won't fall on your knees before Him and say, God, I've sinned before you. God said, I can't work with you. As bad as I want to. I can't give you what I really want to give you because you are not appreciative of what I've already given you. And that's your body, which is the temple of the Holy Ghost. You want to present that back to me. Come on, y'all. That's why the Bible says, don't defile the temple of God, for it is His temple. Can't put it in everything in your body and think God's just going to use you mightily. Didn't y'all see the other day Jesus ate fish and honeycomb? I said He was some kind of man. I like Him. Man, He was a good eater. Because He wasn't allowed to put so much stuff in His body. These bodies are valuable to God. See, the deal is He willing to make an exchange. Somebody say an exchange. He willing to make an exchange with all of us. Give me you, and I'll give me you. What a better payoff. Dude, do you hear me? Give me you, and I will give me you. That's all it is, for God so loved the world that He gave. It's an exchange thing. He died, you live. Now if you live, He's not dying anymore. He's going to continue living. But you need to die that you might live. Are y'all okay? Simple stuff. Full of power. But you have to decide that, okay, what I got in my life right now, is it more valuable? Because this is it. Look at verse number 9. So the Bible says, somebody say, the internal organs and the legs are to be washed. Then the priest will burn them upon the altar, and they will be an acceptable burnt offering with which the Lord is pleased. Yeah. You see that?
Yes, sir.
See, I think more than anything else, we have to narrow it down to this, I would say, least common denominator. Yes. Who do we want to be pleased? Right. Or who do we want to please most? Yes. Because the truth of the matter is, if you really want Him to be pleased, you won't mind going through the process to give God what He wants. Because I tell you, a lot of times in our lives, we will try to please somebody else. That as soon as you please them, you will find that they're displeased with you. Are you here, church?
And you have to decide, no matter what's going on in my life, my first priority of life is to please my Maker. He's the one that made me. He is the one that created me. My first obligation is to please Him. Amen? Now I'm about to close, but here is the power that comes after you present. Somebody say present. The other night I made an acronym for an acrostic rather for the word sacrifice. Today I'm going to make one for present. P, you reap His promises and you experience fulfillment. Because every time you begin presenting yourself, you're going to reap His promises. And you're also going to begin experiencing His, or you're going to experience fulfillment yourself.
All right.
Amen?
Yeah.
R, you find repentance. You understand? You find repentance and you are also restored. Because when you do this, the whole thing was that they would find repentance. They would be restored. When they gave the bull, when they gave the goat to God, God says, now I'm going to remit your sins away from you, back in the Old Testament, for 1 year. Amen? E, you become more educated and at ease about life. Because there's something about a person that give their lives up. They're not frantic. They're not filled with anxiety. They don't have a stroke over the fact that something is not going their way. They find that life is a whole lot easier, praise the Lord, because He said, come unto me, all ye that labor and are heavy laden. I will give you rest. Take my yoke upon you and learn of me, for my yoke is easy. Are y'all here, praise the Lord? And my burdens, they are light. You find yourself walking in a more easier way of life, praise the Lord. Then somebody say, S. You might be singled out and you're more stationary for God. God might single you out, but that's okay. You're more stationary for God. And that's what we want, praise the Lord. I want to be singled out for God and I want Him to stabilize me. Amen? In other words, I don't want to be tossed with every wind of doctrine, tossed to and fro with everything that comes my way. Does that make sense? And you find that this happens whenever you begin to give yourself and present yourself unto God. Amen? Somebody say E. Amen. You're more engaged and also you're more excited about the things of God.
Yeah.
Have you noticed that people that have presented themselves to God, they're more engaged, they're more excited about the things of God, praise the Lord.
Yeah.
Other people that have not presented themselves completely because they're not dead yet, you ever seen us, praise the Lord, roll in here, live man, praise the Lord, in the coffin? Don't, and we are scared the mess out of somebody. Amen. But here we have, if we have a dead man, everybody know that he's dead. He can't do much to us. But if you're alive, praise the Lord. If that rascal fool don't rise up, then everybody's scattering. But see now, if you got somebody dead and alive in Christ, that person's excited. Why? The joy of the Lord is their strength. They're excited. They're engaged. They're focused. You see? And then somebody say, in. You're more neighborly and you're more nurturing. You're concerned about people, praise the Lord. You're more neighborly, you're more nurturing. Because why? You're concerned about people. People that have not repented, people that have not given themselves to God, you can just about rest assured that there is no way possible they're going to be that concerned about somebody else. They got too many hang-ups of themselves. They got too many issues going on in their own life. How in the world am I going to be really concerned about God and the things of God when I got too many hang-ups? I'm alive in here. Then lastly, you become tough and you become more tactful. Why? Because, listen, dead men are dead. God raises them up to the newness of life. They become tough for God. They become more tactful for God. And they know how to give glory to God. Amen? Let's give our God a hand of prayer. Come on, let's give God a prayer. I say God, this is not me, this is him.